Well, now that we've completely forgotten what eating or sleeping feels like, we've played almost 90 hours of this game less than a week in. So I think it's finally time for things I wish I knew earlier in Pokemon Brilliant Diamond and Shining Pearl. I want to make sure that everybody can get something out of this video, so we're going to start off with some more basic tips for newcomers to the franchise, and then we're going to move on to some more complex stuff, so even veterans of the series can hopefully learn something new. So, without wasting any more time, let's jump right into it. The first tip I want to share with you guys is related to the honey trees. Once we get to Floroma Town, we'll go into the fields just to the north, we'll be introduced to the mechanic of putting honey on the trees, and then returning to the tree 6 hours later to find a Pokemon in that tree, and have a chance of it being a rare Pokemon such as Munchlax, for example. And the thing I want to point out here is that many people, including myself, didn't notice until many, many hours in, is that you don't need to remember the location of all these honey trees. If we go into our world map and press the plus button and then R1 a couple of times, we can actually see the location of all of the honey trees on the map. The white symbols are the ones that don't have any honey on them. The ones that are colored in but aren't shining are the ones that have honey and are still waiting the 6 hours to be harvested. And finally, the last tab, the ones that are shining, mean that the 6 hours have passed and the Pokemon is ready to be encountered. Also, quick side note, if you let 24 hours go past and you don't actually fight the Pokemon, it'll expire and you'll have to put the honey on again and you'll miss out on the fight. Next up, it's a very interesting feature they've included in these versions of the games. And that is, at the start of the fight, sometimes there can be a special animation. The special animation consists of, as soon as the fight starts, before the camera goes over the enemy Pokemon as it usually would, you'll get a bit of a shot of the camera panning over your own character. I'll put an example here on the screen so you guys can see it. When you get this animation at the start of a wild encounter, definitely try to catch that Pokemon, as this means that that Pokemon has at least 2 perfect IVs. Now we're going to go in depth on what IVs exactly are later on in this video as it's a little bit more advanced, but for now just associate high IVs with high stats in that category. Like I said, we'll segue back into the IV topic a little bit later on in this video. A few tips for early game to make sure you get off to a great start is, once you beat the first gym and then you beat the double fight you do in Route 204, I believe it is, you can go to the TV station building here in Jubilife City, go to the 3rd floor and speak with the NPC down here, and then choose the last option, the option that's all in caps, and this will unlock the mystery gift feature. This has been in many other games. It allows you to insert codes and sort of events online and stuff to get special Pokemon and rewards such as Pokeballs and stuff like that. The main reason for this, at least right now, is so you can get yourself a free Manaphy Egg. This is a legendary Pokemon you can get for simply unlocking the mystery gift option and clicking on online. You can instantly get the egg for the legendary Manaphy, which is a great water type to have for early game. Now, speaking of great legendaries to have for early game, I'm sure you've probably heard of this, but just in case you haven't, if you go to Floroma Town and have a save file of Pokemon Sword and Shield, and speak to this old man here, he'll give you a completely free Hitachi, which is yet another legendary. And what's even more amazing is that if you speak to the woman right next to him, if you have a save file from Let's Go Eevee or Let's Go Pikachu, you'll get a completely free Mew. That's right, the legendary can be obtained by simply having a save file from Let's Go Eevee and Let's Go Pikachu. Next up, when we go south from Heart Home City, we'll eventually come across this mansion. This is going to be the Trophy Garden, which I was aware that this place existed, and I've even been there a few times, as you can get Pikachu and Pichu, and I was told you could get some pretty nice Pokemon in there, such as Jigglypuff, even Porygon. However, I wasn't exactly aware of the mechanic. The way this works is there's an NPC in the room, which is the owner of the mansion, and when you speak to him each day, he will claim that there's a specific Pokemon, let's say Porygon, in his garden. And as there's not actually one there, he will quickly send his assistant off to go and fetch one and bring them to the garden so that there are that Pokemon in the garden. And now the trick to this is, make sure you speak to this guy every single day, as every day he will bring in a new Pokemon. And they do accumulate, so if today he brings in Pikachu and next day let's say he brings in Meowth, there will still be the Jigglypuff from the day before. You want to make sure you're doing this every day just to accumulate all of those Pokemon into the garden, so that way when you do want to get them, they're already there, and you don't have to wait for more days to pass. Though it is important to note that this mechanic only becomes available after obtaining the National Dex. Something I definitely recommend in this game is checking out your options, as there's quite a few interesting ones there. Autosave is definitely something you want to disable as soon as possible. Just remember to save pretty often, which is the way you've always done it in Pokemon games. Autosave in Pokemon can really screw you up. There's so many things that you're kind of likely to want to reset or go back on. Also, if you're like me and never really put nicknames onto your Pokemon, definitely disable that automatically, so it doesn't ask you every single time you catch a Pokemon if you want to give it a nickname. If you're in late game just grinding away for levels, you can also disable the attack animations to make the fights go a bit quicker. I don't generally like doing this playing through the game, as they are really nice animations on this, but if you are grinding, like I said, just to speed things up, you can actually disable the animations. Let's dive in a little bit to the topic of breeding and egg hatching in this game. So the general concept is if you leave two Pokemon from the same egg group at the daycare center together, one male and one female, eventually if they are the same egg type, the man outside will say they laid an egg. You get the egg and then you walk around for a bit, and after X amount of steps, the egg will hatch, and inside the egg you get the base state version of the female Pokemon you left at the daycare center. This can be used to try to breed Pokemon with perfect IVs or to try and get shiny Pokemons a lot easier, and a few things that if you are a newcomer to the game, you may not have realized. The first thing is that a Ditto is the best friend of any breeder. The reason Ditto is so amazing is that it can actually breed with pretty much any Pokemon that can be bred, even if they are male or female, it doesn't matter, you always get a smaller version of the other Pokemon. The exceptions obviously are legendaries that can't be bred, except Manaphy that can be bred just to get Fioni. So if you manage to get a Ditto with really good IVs, you are definitely in luck. Now something really amazing, and it just goes to show how in depth they really think of mechanics in this, is a thing called the Masuda method. The Masuda method consists of if you have a friend in a different country, a completely different region, and they send you a Pokemon, and you leave it in the daycare center to breed with a Pokemon of your country, they actually have an increased chance of getting shiny Pokemon. So if you're lucky enough to have a friend from a different country, or in the message boards, or even you can try to arrange this in the comments down below, you can all get together and sort of trade each other Dittos from different regions, and this way you can all have increased chance of breeding shinies. Now that's enough about actually breeding them, but when it comes to hatching the eggs, some of them can require a lot of steps. Some of them can even require up to like 10, 12,000 steps to hatch the Pokemon. But this really cool trick that's been around for quite a few generations now is that some Pokemon have the passive ability called Flame Body or Magma Armor. Now Pokemon with these abilities, if you put them in the party next to an egg, it actually reduces the amount of steps it takes by 55% approximately. Which means while that Pokemon is in your party and you're walking around with the egg, it'll require less than half the amount of steps it would usually take to hatch that Pokemon. A really good Pokemon you can get from the fire biomes down in the underground is Mikago. Mikago has a chance of having the Flame Body ability. With this, it becomes much quicker to hatch all of your eggs. One more thing quickly related to the breeding on this game, as it is a pretty major part of the Pokemon experience, is that when you beat the Elite Four, you can come down here to the Valor Lakefront and speak with this NPC in the pool. This is actually one of the game developers from the Game Freak team, and if you beat him, you get a thing called the Oval Charm. The Oval Charm makes it so when there's two Pokemon left in the daycare center, it's quicker for them to make an egg, it pretty much just speeds up the process. Now that we're in this area in the Valor Lakefront, if you go into the building and speak with the NPC on the left, if you've seen all 150 Pokemon from the Sinnoh region, you actually get the Catchin' Charm. What the Catchin' Charm does is it increases the chance of getting a critical capture. These are the times you throw the Pokeball and it instantly captures the Pokemon without even spinning around. And a lot of interesting things in the Valor Lakefront apparently. Before we even leave this building, the character on the left down here, the sound designer, he will also be able to give us the item so that we can enable the original DS soundtrack for this game instead of the updated remastered version. So if you enjoy a bit of nostalgia, that's definitely a really cool feature. Now a couple of items you definitely want to get as early as you possibly can. The first one is going to be the Lucky Egg. The Lucky Egg is amazing, it's actually an item that increases the amount of XP we obtain every single fight. And to obtain it, we will need to have made it to Snow Point City, which is the north snowy area. Once we're here in front of Lake Acuity, we want to use the digging kit to go to the Grand Underground. Then just follow the pathway I'm shown here in the gameplay to the left, and when we get to this room, there's going to be an item. This item on the ground right here is going to be the Lucky Egg. Unfortunately, I didn't grab it until after the Elite Four, but if you grab this early on the first time you visit this area, you're definitely going to have quite the advantage. Also, something I feel kind of embarrassed to put in a tips and tricks video, but at the same time, so many people have asked me on a few videos of how you actually leave the underground that I actually feel forced to put this in here. When you're in the underground, all you have to do is press the Y button on the controller pad and then choose to go up. A lot of people have problems with this because they press the plus button as if the same way they got down here, and they've been trapped in the underground ever since. So if you are having trouble getting out the underground, there you have it. Now we're on the topic of embarrassing little tips you may have not have realized that are quite obvious, is something I included in the tips and tricks video for Sword and Shield as well, and I was glad to see that I wasn't the only one that didn't realize this instantly, is that in combat there's actually a shortcut button to go directly to your Pokeball's bag instead of having to go down to your bag individually each time. Simply press the X button when you're in a fight and it'll instantly take you to the menu to throw a Pokeball or whatever other ball you wish to throw. And this, when you're on the easy journey to catch them all, is definitely speeding up the process quite a bit. Now moving on to some more late game stuff, once we've already beat the Elite Four and got the National Pokedex, we'll come up here to the Northern Little Island. And specifically, we're going to be heading for Route 228. In this route, there's going to be a house, and inside, there's going to be a move tutor, but not just any. This is the NPC that teaches ultimate moves to the final evolutions of all of the starter Pokemon. That means each of your starter's final evolutions can learn very special attacks. There's obviously one for water, one for fire, and one for grass type. And the cool thing about this is it's not actually only the starters from this generation. You can go into the underground and get the starters from all of the other generations, all the way up from 1 to 4, and their final evolutions can also learn these ultimate attacks. Now, one more quick tip before we jump into EV training and IVs, which is probably the most complex part about this game. We're going to show you a really cool tip for catching roaming legendaries such as Cresselia and Mesprit. The main problem with these Pokemon is that they roam around, and even then, when we do finally catch up to them, they flee after just one turn, so it becomes quite the grind to get them all the way down and then capture them. However, there are a few select Pokemon with a passive ability called Shadow Tag. A good example of this is Wobbuffet. So if our Pokemon, in this case Wobbuffet, is out with Shadow Tag, it makes it so the enemy can never run away from the battle as long as our Pokemon stays in the fight. So this gives us as much time as we need to capture these legendaries without them running away, or at least as long as Wobbuffet survives. To catch Wobbuffet, really easy. Once you have the Pokeradar, go to any of the three lakes and just simply use the Pokeradar in the grass, and there's a chance of getting a Wobbuffet. Now finally, let's speak a little bit about EVs and IVs. What exactly are these? For those of you who maybe haven't really looked into the competitive scene at all, these may be completely new concepts to you. They are both hidden stats that, to begin with, can't really be seen on your Pokemon. So even if two Pokemon are the exact same level, one could have very different stats than another. So the difference between EVs and IVs is that EVs can be trained and altered depending on what Pokemon you kill, where IVs are pretty much set in stone stats that the Pokemon starts with that you're pretty much just stuck with. We mentioned you can't really alter the IVs of your Pokemon, it's what they start with and it's what they're stuck with, and that is true, kind of. There is a way to actually improve your IVs of your Pokemon and get them all to best. The way to do this is using bottle caps. So bottle caps will increase one specific IV stat all the way to best. The only way to obtain battle caps is an exchange of 25 battle points from the battle tower, so this can take quite a long time to farm them. This can be done, you can actually max out all of your perfect IVs if you wish to. An important fact you should definitely know is you can only use bottle caps on Pokemon that are already level 100. If it's not level 100, you can't max out its IVs in any way. Now, IVs in this game, you have actually got a way in late game of checking what the stats on your Pokemon are. All you want to do is go to the battle tower up here after beating the Elite Four, and speak with this researcher here on the right hand side. He will give you the judge ability, and with this, when you're in your box, you can see here on the right hand side the IVs, not directly the numbers, but pretty much like if they're good or bad, of each of your Pokemon. So what we're looking out for here is any Pokemon that has best on more than a few of the stats. As you can see here, our Mew, for example, has best on 4 different stats, which is absolutely amazing. And turns out, after trading up all my evolutions, I finally went to check this, and turns out they weren't as amazing as I was hoping. Now, the EVs are the hidden points that go into each stat every time we defeat a specific Pokemon. And again, this is something the game never explicitly explains to you, however it is something that is known from quite a long time in pretty much every generation of Pokemon games. So depending on what Pokemon you defeat, every single time you defeat one, you get one hidden point put into one stat depending on what Pokemon that was. So let's say you defeat a Geodude in combat. Every time you defeat a Geodude, you get plus 1 point into your defense stat that never really shows up anywhere. However, it is there, and they do have a limit of how many you can get. So when you are training for perfect EVs, if you want specific stats really high, you do need to be careful in exactly what Pokemon you are defeating with that Pokemon. Now, I've explained this just so you guys know what we're talking about when you hear people talk about EV training. Now, on these remakes, luckily, you don't really need to EV train at all. The reason for this is that you can buy the vitamins such as protein, zinc, calcium, which artificially boost these stats permanently, and you can just buy as many as you like of these as long as you have enough cash. Now, you could always buy these items in previous games before. However, previously, you would have a limit of how much you could artificially boost these stats. In this, you can literally artificially boost these stats as much as you like until you reach the limit, completely by feeding them vitamins without the need to have a single fight. Which is kind of cool, depending on what side of the fence you're on. Some people enjoy the EV training, even though it can be quite tedious. It is a pretty major part of the competitive scene. Which, I guess, we should end this video on a note of how to get a ton of money really, really fast. Simply for the reason, if we are going to be feeding our Pokemon all these vitamins, we're going to need a lot of cash as they are really expensive. Luckily for us, in this version of the game, there's actually a really, really easy way of making loads of money, which I was a bit hesitant putting in this video as literally everybody has already uploaded this one, but I thought I would include it anyway as it is quite a nice find. The first thing we're going to need is the Amulet Coin, which is simply an item we can equip onto our Pokemon, and if that Pokemon participated in the battle, at the end of the fight, we get double the amount of money we'd usually get. You can get the Amulet Coin by going to Heart Home City and then going up to Amenity Square. Once you're in Amenity Square, you want to go to these hut cave sort of things on the top right hand side, and inside you'll find the Amulet Coin. So just throw that on your whichever Pokemon you're going to use for farming money. And then we're going to go down here to Route 212, just to the left of the Trophy Garden. Now here we're going to find this couple of old Pokemon trainers. They aren't actually a double fight though. What we want to do is we want to fight one and then the other one, And we'll notice they only have one Pokemon each. And when we have the amulet coin equipped, each one is going to drop us a whopping 16,000 Pokédollars. And this is where the Versus Seeker comes into play. If we just sort of walk around for a little bit, not long, you can just go to the house and back maybe a couple of times. And when you come back, you can use the Versus Seeker, which will make it so you can refight the same trainers that are close by. And the good thing is, if you use it right in the middle of them, you can actually reactivate both of them at the same time, so you can re-challenge both of them. Each one of them, like I said, has one Pokemon, you can wipe them out really easily, get 16,000, fight the other one, get another 16,000, walk around for a little bit, come back, and then do the same thing as many times as you like. And it can be really helpful if you are planning on buying those vitamins for your EVs. Anyway guys, that is it. As usual, definitely leave in the comments down below if you found these tips useful, or if you have any other great tips you would like to share with the community if you are a veteran player. I hope you did find this video helpful. If you did, don't forget to thumbs up on it and subscribe for more content coming very soon, and we'll see you next time.